الحمد لله رب العالمين، وأفضل الصلاة وتم التسليم على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا وانفعنا بما علمتنا وزدنا علما وفقنا للدين يا رب العالمين. We finished the studies of the Umayyad dynasty, and we got to the last few years of the Umayyad dynasty and the rise of the Abbasid. We studied the factors that contributed to the fall of Bani Umayyah. This is why this dynasty had to be finished. Number one, they introduced the dynasty concept, that the Khilafah will be transferred from father to son, from brother to brother, and it remains within one family, and that gives a family right to the Khilafah of Islam. And this is a new concept that was not known at the time of the guided Khalifa of Al-Khulafa al-Rashidin. And that led into a lot of conflict, especially inside the house of Umayyah, and also brought animosity from outside the house of Umayyah towards the house of Umayyah. The other thing is they tried to use national and tribal zealotry in association and played tribes against each other. And that actually came back to haunt them at the end, like we will see in our study of the rise of the Abbasids. There were some political and military alliances inside one government which will only bring division into the one body of the Islamic state. And we saw that there was conflict inside the House of Umayyah. We'll go over that tonight, inshallah. One other thing that brought directly the end of the Umayyad dynasty was the oppression of the Shia, the oppression of the followers of Ali, radiallahu anhu. And like we said, we will study the different types of Shia, like we started to do in the last session, and how that played a major political role in the downfall of the Umayyad dynasty. And then the Umayyad, many of the Umayyad Khalifa, not all of them, we studied with a major exception, who was Umar ibn Abdul Aziz. Many of them were distracted by wealth, by power, by expansion of the empire, from the real message of the Khilafah. The real message, Khalifa means the successor of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That's the meaning of it. That means that the person that is given and entrusted with this position has to play the role of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as much as possible. In fact, to live up to the legacy of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, not to the legacy of Caesar, not to the legacy of Khosrow, not to be an emperor, not to be a king, is to be a Khalifa. And that is a different meaning on the leadership and authority in Islam. The time of many Umayyah is really filled with revolts and revolutions. And we know how in the 61st year after the Hijra, the events of Karbala, and the revolt of Al-Hawran and Medina, 63rd year after the Hijra, then the revolt of Ibn Zubayr, who is a Khalifa by many scholars from 63 to 73. There was Al-Ash'ath ibn Qais revolt in 81 after the Hijra. There was Yazid ibn Muhallab revolt in 102nd year after the Hijra. There is Abdullah ibn Muawiyah revolt in 127 year after the Hijra. There is the Hamas revolt, and then the Sulaiman ibn Hisham revolt, and this is actually a revolt within the house of Umayyah. But if you just look at all these revolts in the timeline, it was still, in the whole time of Bani Umayyah, was really a time of turmoil, one revolt after the other, and that all culminated at the end to bring down the house of Umayyah. And that was done by the Abbasid. So who are the Abbasid? Who are these Abbasidun? The Abbasidun are related to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and they are from the house of Hashim in the tribe of Quraysh, where the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came from. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he is the son Muhammad ibn Abdullah ibn Abdul Muttalib ibn Hashim ibn Abdul Manaf sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And Abdul Muttalib had, as we know, 10 male children of them. We recognize Al-Abbas ibn Abdul Muttalib, Abu Talib ibn Abdul Muttalib, and Abdullah ibn Abdul Muttalib, who is the father of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Well, Al-Abbasiyun came from Al-Abbas ibn Abdul Muttalib. That's where the Abbasid dynasty came from. And we know Ali ibn Talib came from the brother of Al-Abbas and brother of Abdullah, who is Al-Talib. But the famous son of Al-Abbas is one of the scholars of Islam, is Abdullah ibn Abbas, radiallahu anhumah. And From Abdullah ibn Abbas, he had a son, his name was Ali ibn Abdullah ibn al-Abbas, and we will see why Ali was important, because he was the first one to actually start working towards forming a dynasty in the house of al-Abbas. Get the pointer here. The Abbasid are the cousins of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They are the direct cousins of Ali ibn Abi Talib, who had, we know, the three main children. Ali ibn Talib had many children, by the way, but the three recognized ones in history are the sons of Fatima, al-Hasan and al-Husayn, by Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the grandchildren of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and then Muhammad ibn Ali, who is Muhammad ibn Hanafiya. And also wanted to pay attention to that, because this will play a role in the alliances of the Shia at that time. Muhammad ibn Ali ibn Abdullah ibn Abd al-Abbas is another important person, who is the grandson of Abdullah ibn Abbas, radiallahu anhu, and played a major role, as we will study, inshallah, tonight. First, I would like to speak a little bit about the events. We studied both the events of Ali, the conflict between Ali radiallahu anhu and Muawiyah, and then how Muawiyah was given the Khilafah by the Bay'ah of al-Hasan ibn Ali radiallahu anhu, and the house of Umayyah became dominance over the Khilafah. But that left major bitterness in the hearts of the supporters of Ali radiallahu anhu, who basically were mostly settled in South Iraq and in al-Iraq, and mostly in the city of al-Kufa. And the supporters of Ali radiallahu anhu were known as the Shia Ali. Now, the Shia was not recognized as the religion sect that we know today. They were basically the supporters of Ali who could not recognize the authority of Bani Umayyah. They thought and believed that Bani Umayyah took the right of Khilafah from Ali radiallahu anhu. But they among themselves were divided into different alliances. There were two different Shia initially at first. There was a Shia Imamiya who believed that Ali Zayn al-Abidin should have been the Khalifa after his father Hussein ibn Ali radiallahu anhu was slaughtered in Karbala, and Ali Zayn al-Abidin has the right to become Khalifa. However, when Ali Zayn al-Abidin, he, number one, was not given the bay'ah for Khilafah. I mean, in many narrations in history, he refused to go out and fight for it or ask for the Khilafah. He was an imam, he was a scholar, but he was not somebody who wanted to play any political adventures trying to capture the Khilafah and the leadership. However, when Abdullah ibn Zubayr was in Mecca and he had his Khilafah, he sent a man called Al-Muhtar ibn Abi Ubaid al-Thaqafi, sent him to Al-Iraq to get the alliance of the Shia against the house of Umayyah. When Al-Muhtar ibn Ubaid got there, he asked for Muhammad ibn Ali, Muhammad ibn al-Hanafiyya, to become the Khalifa. Muhammad ibn al-Hanafiyya, who is the son of Ali, but not a son of Fatima, who is the son of Ali radiallahu anhu from a different mother. And he started calling for him to be the Imam. Where Muhammad ibn Hanafiyya did not want to become the Khalifa himself. So then later on, Al-Mukhtar ibn Ubayd al-Thaqafi, whose title was Kaysan, his nickname was Kaysan, he started calling for himself to be a Khalifa, and then later on he was slaughtered and killed in Al-Kufa. But the people that gathered around him, and they had the support for Muhammad ibn Ali, were called Ash-Shia al-Kaysaniyya, the Kaysani Shia. And they were now a different sect from Ash-Shia al-Imamiyya. And they were around Muhammad ibn Ali. But then when Muhammad ibn Ali died, they started getting around his son Abu Hashim. Abu Hashim ibn Muhammad ibn Ali. And they started calling Abu Hashim their Imam, while Ash-Shia al-Imamiyya were calling Ali Zayn al-Abidin their Imam. Well, later on, when Abu Hashim died, he gave the leadership. His will was the leadership of his group, Ash-Shia al-Kaysaniyya, to go to Ali ibn Abdullah ibn al-Abbas.
So Shia and Qaysaniyya started having their alliance to the Abbasid. And they were the core base where the Abbasid based, where the Abbasids tried to actually build their dynasty upon. This is the Shia and Qaysaniyya, and it moved from Abu Hashim, the son of Muhammad ibn Ali, to Ali ibn Abdullah ibn Abbas. Any questions at this point? I know it's a little bit complicated.
I think that maybe you can explain this, that there were two sons of Zain al-Abidin.
Yes, that's coming.
Yeah. Are you going to?
Yes, I will. Yes, okay. Yeah, that's coming. Inshallah, just on the next slide. The time frame in that, this was Abu Hashim died just before the 100th year after the hijrah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So this is in the end of second, third of the Umayyad dynasty, when things were happening, when the Shia were dividing. This is all after, this is actually even after the death of Ali Zayn al-Abidin. And like Dr. Rahman said, there have two sons, and that will actually even divide the Shia and Umayyad more after that. And that will be, as we will see maybe in the next slide. So now Shia and Qaysaniyya had their alliance with Muhammad ibn Ali ibn Abdullah ibn Abbas. Okay? And they are now supporters to bring the Khilafah back to the house of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The da'wah, al-da'wah al-abbasiyya, hiya da'wah shi'iyya. It is a call to bring the Khilafah back to the house of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Al-bayt. Al-bayt. The people of the house of the Prophet. And the Shia al-Qaysaniyya did not differentiate that Ali ibn al-Abidin or Abu Hashim or Abdullah ibn Abbas, they're all from the house of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And all they wanted to do is to bring the Khilafah back from the Umayyah to the house of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So they supported Muhammad ibn Ali ibn Abdullah ibn al-Abbas. However, when Ali ibn al-Abidin died, he had two sons, Zayd ibn Ali ibn al-Husayn and Muhammad ibn Ali ibn al-Husayn. Now Zayd ibn Ali ibn al-Husayn had a group around him, and they were called the Shia to Zaydiyya. And they are currently most of the Shia in Yemen, who are from that particular sect. And the people that went around Muhammad ibn Ali, who was titled Muhammad al-Baqir, were known as the Shia al-Imamiyya. And from that group developed the Shia sect, the Shia al-Imamiyya sect that is known also as the Shia al-Ithna'ashariyya. That is known today in Iran and parts of Pakistan and in Lebanon, South Lebanon, and others. However, it's very important to understand that for us, the people of the Sunnah, we don't recognize Muhammad al-Baqir or Ja'far al-Sadiq as people who are Shia. They are Sunni Imams, and they are respected and revered in our tradition, like because they are Sunni and they follow the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They never deviated from the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. For this group to be around them, or for this people to claim them as their imam, does not mean to us, the people of the Sunnah, that they were Shia, that they were not Sunni, not from this on the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam.
Followers of Shia, not their imam.
Right, exactly. The followers of Shia, and as a matter of fact, the Shia were called Rafida, the rejectors. And the reason they got the title of Rafida is that when they went to Zayd ibn Ali ibn al-Husayn, and they wanted to join with him and get his approval to be their imam, they asked him to curse Abu Bakr and Umar. And he rejected that.
Zayd was more qualified, he was a better person.
Right, right.
And he
was an imam, and he was in al-Kufa, and he said, I cannot curse Abu Bakr and Umar. And I have never heard my father cursing Abu Bakr and Umar. And have never heard anybody, righteous person cursing Abu Bakr or Umar. And they said, فَإِذَا نَفْضُلُكَ, then we reject you. And he said, yes, that's up to you. And that's why they call the rejectors or Rafida. And actually this title is still there known, and that's happened in many, in the Muslim world today. So the important, idea of this is that Shia, the call to bring the Khilafah back to the house of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, was the base of the Abbasi da'wah. The base of the Abbasi call, the base of the Abbasi claim, is to bring the Khilafah back to the house of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Well, many of the Sunni scholars later on recognize this as much of a deviation as calling for the Khilafah in the house of Umayyah or in the house of Uthman, or in the house of anybody, because the Khilafah has to be shura among the Muslims, and the Khilafah cannot go into a certain dynasty according to our tradition, the tradition of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the tradition of the guided Khilafah. So regardless of the house that you call the Khilafah to, it doesn't matter, it does not go along with the sunnah of the Khulafa al-Rashidin to be in any particular dynasty. However, the Abbasids and the Shia and today the Imamis are all calling for Khilafah to become in a certain house. The hadith of the Prophet ﷺ that it has to be in Quraysh, as long as Quraysh can fulfill the requirements and the responsibility of the Khilafah, and if they could not, then it can go outside Quraysh. The son of Muhammad al-Baqir was Ja'far al-Sadiq, and Ja'far al-Sadiq was also claimed by the Shia to be their Imam, and the Madhab al-Ja'fari, the Ja'fari school, is based on the school of Ja'far al-Sadiq. However, if you read the Sunni books, Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq is recognized as a Sunni Imam, and his fatwa, his fatawa, his ruling and his ideas are recognized as Sunni rulings, and you will see him quoted in many, many Sunni books. So according to the people of the Sunnah, he is a Sunni Imam. And he is one of the great scholars. And he is counted as one of the main scholars of Islam, with really with the rank of Abu Hanifa and Malik and Imam Ahmad and Imam Shafi'i. So I want also to bring about that very important recognition of Ja'far al-Sadiq radiallahu anhu.
What about the Shias?
They called him one of their 12 imams, starting with Ali, Hassan, Al-Hassan, Hussein, Ali, Zayn al-Abi, Muhammad, Baqir, Ja'far, Salih, etc. So, that's the atmosphere at the end of the Umayyad dynasty. And so, like I said, the Abbasid call was depending on the Shia principle to bring the Khilafah back to the house of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And the first revolt against Umayyah, based on this particular principle, was the revolt of Zayd. The revolt of Zayd, the son of Ali Zayn al-Abidin radiallahu anhuma, and that was after the 100th year of the Hijrah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And it was led by Zayd, and it was led in Kufa. And what happened is it was a revolt that was quickly planned and quickly executed, and it did not have great public support, it did not have a lot of military power behind it, and it was completely crushed by Bani Umayyah, and Imam Zayd was killed. And his son after him took the leadership of the revolution, and he was also killed. So both Imam Zayd and Imam Yahya, son of son of Ali Zayn al-Abidin, were both killed by the house of Bani Umayyah. And that actually just increased the anger in the hearts of the supporters of Ali and the Shia, both regardless of their Kaysani, Zaydi, or Imani. And that actually started bringing about the downfall of the Umayyad dynasty. So how did that happen? It happened when Muhammad ibn Ali ibn Abdullah ibn Abbas, Muhammad ibn Ali ibn Abdullah ibn Abbas, he became the actual brain behind the planning for the rise of the Abbasid dynasty. How did that happen? He basically started planning the long-term structure of a dawah. Long-term structure of this, I shouldn't call it a cult, because it has no specific religious differences other than the goal to bring down the house of Umayyah. So to do that, they started thinking, and Muhammad ibn Ali ibn Abdullah ibn Abbas started thinking about what would be the best way to do that. They said that we have to have bases of our da'wah. Well, Al-Kufa is the capital of Ali, radiallahu anhu. Ali ibn Abi Talib. It was his capital. The supporters of Ali were all settled in Al-Kufa. So they decided to use Al-Kufa and the people of Al-Kufa as one base. But they wanted another base. They wanted another place where they can actually move freely, not under the eyes of Umayyah, because we know the eyes of Umayyah were always on Al-Kufa. And this is the Hajjaj and Yusuf al-Thaqafi from Iraq. They always knew that Al-Kufa is going to be a center of headache for them, and they had a lot of observation over Al-Kufa. So how did the House of Abbas, how did they move? They decided to lead, to start their call in Khurasan. Why Khurasan? Khurasan is far from the stronghold of Umayyah in Asham, and even their stronghold in Al-Iraq. The other thing is the people of Persia and Khurasan are used to the idea of monarchy, meaning dynasty form of governments. And it's very easy for them to understand at that particular time in history that the ultimate leader is the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and it's natural for the offspring and family of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to be the natural leaders after the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And it was a very easy sale to the people of Persia and Khorasan, and they had great support in those areas. The third important thing that Umayyah did not treat the territory, the new territory that was conquered by Umayyah, by the Muslim armies at that time, they treated as colonies, as places where they can bring the bad wealth and power to the capital in Damascus. And the people, they want to use the people of Khorasan and the people of Persia and the people of the new territory to increase the wealth of and the power of the Khalifa in Damascus. And we talked about that a little bit. So there was some resentment in those territories against the people of Umayyah. And it was easy to recruit in those territories against the House of Umayyah. And this secretive phase of Ad-Da'wah started in the 100 or 101st year after the Hijrah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and started, and Ali ibn Abdullah ibn Abbas was still alive. And then his son Muhammad, like we said, he was the major planner and the one that actually drew the plan, and he planned this great revolution of the House of Abbas. And he sent people to Khurasan to represent him, but his base remained in Al-Kufa. So it took, like we see, the last Khalifa of Umayyah died in 132 years after the Hijrah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It took about 30 years for the Abbasi to plan and execute the revolution against the House of Umayyah. And that actually explains the success of this da'wah and the failure of the other revolts that were mostly done in a few months and quick revolts. So this took really a generation. There was a whole generation of fighters, a whole generation of soldiers that were brought about under that call, under the call of at-Tashayyu, or the support of Bani Abbas. There were two major events that actually helped the Abbasids at that time. One of them, there was division inside the House of Umayyah. Two factors that actually helped the Abbasids in their success. One of them is the division inside the House of Umayyah, and then there was division among the Arab tribes, which held the power and armies in Khorasan and Persia. And we will go over that real quick. The first one is division inside the House of Umayyah. The Khalifa after Hisham ibn Abd al-Malik ibn Marwan was the second Walid, and after him was Yazid al-Thani. Now, Walid al-Thani, who is the son of Yazid from Abd al-Malik ibn Marwan, was brought to the Khilafah after Hisham ibn Abd al-Malik. So he got it from his uncle. What was particular about al-Walid ibn Yazid ibn Abd al-Malik, who is called al-Walid al-Thani, is he was not a religious person. On the contrary, he was an alcoholic. He was addicted to alcohol, and he was all busy in his fun and enjoying the wealth and enjoying the power of Umayyah. And his nickname was al-Walid al-Fasiq. His Khalifa said al-Khalifa al-Adil, al-Khalifa al-Salih. His name was al-Khalifa al-Fasiq, meaning, you know, the sinner. And the House of Umayyah, many of them were angry with al-Walid, but something happened that his cousin, Yazid ibn al-Walid, now he is, you know, it's really confusing, because the Khalifa is al-Walid ibn Yazid, and his cousin is Yazid ibn al-Walid. And they had only a few names in the house of Umayyah. Use them over and over again. So Yazid revolted against his cousin and killed him. He killed his cousin Al-Walid ibn Yazid on 126 after the year after the hijrah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Well, that, and he said, when after he killed him, his eye did not kill him because I wanted to be a khalifa. I only killed him because of his fisq, because of his sinning, because of his deviation from our tradition, and that split the house of Umayyah. Marwan ibn Muhammad, who was the 12th khalifa in Umayyah and the last khalifa of Umayyah, went out and revolted against Yazid. And he said he wants to revenge against the killing of his nephew, Al-Walid ibn Yazid. However, Yazid himself dies after 6 months of his khilafah. He was not killed, he just died naturally. And Marwan was leading a revolt against Yazid. So there were revolt inside the house of Umayyah. There were Umayyad fighting Umayyads. And that actually weakened that dynasty and weakened the house of Umayyah. And in the 127th year, Marwan became the last khalifa in the house of Umayyah. The other event, and this is a little bit difficult, but I'm going to go through it, inshallah, quickly. If we have questions, we'll talk about it. Arab tribes were given by Umayyah the rule of Persia and Khorasan. The rule to govern Persia and Khorasan was not given to the people of those territories. It was given to Arab tribes. And they moved Arab tribes from Arabia, like they did into Ash-Sham, Syria, and Iraq. They moved them into those areas. And the majority of Arabs in Khorasan were Yemeni, were Arab Qahtani, called Al-Arab Yemeniya Qahtaniya. And the minority were Nizari. And from Nizar, there are two major tribes, Rabi'a and Mudar. Now, there was a governor who was Yemeni, and he was liked by the majority of the Arabs at that time. His name was Asad ibn Abdullah al-Qusari. And he was removed by Hisham ibn Abdul Malik. And another governor was appointed who was Nasr ibn Musayyar. Nasr ibn Musayyar was from the minority, who were from Mudar. And Mudar and Rabi'a are Nizari, and Quraysh actually goes back to the same lineage, to the Nizari lineage. And that's why Hisham had support for Nasr ibn Sayyar against the Yemenis. The Yemenis were mostly, with the majority of Arabs at that time. So what happened is they had a leader and they revolted against the governor that were appointed by Bani Umayyah. And they became one of the anti-Umayyah tribes, and that is Al-Arab Yamaniya. And they started fighting Nasr ibn Sayyar, who was the pro-Umayyah governor of Khorasan. Well, Rabi'a had their alliance to Al-Khawarij, to the people that were revolting against both of them. And in all that turmoil in Khorasan, this is fertile ground for the Abbasid to have their own army, their own loyalty, and to play people against each other. And in that, there came a name that is very well known in Islamic history, and his name is Abu Muslim al-Khurasani. Abu Muslim al-Khurasani was a mawla. He was a slave, and he was freed, and he had alliance to the Shia al-Kaysaniya, or the supporters of al-Abbasi. And he was appointed by Ibrahim ibn Muhammad, who was the Imam of the Shia in the Kufa, to lead the Shia in Khorasan. And he started gathering armies. He was a young man, and he was a very fierce fighter, and he started gathering force, calling to the call of the Shia to bring the Khilafah back to the house of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. An important notion here, that Umayyah knew that Abu Muslim was a rebel, but they did not know who he was calling for, which particular person he was calling for to be a khalifa. When the revolution, for example, of Zayd ibn Ali, they knew that if they killed Zayd, that was the person that they are calling for. But with Abu Muslim, Umayyah had no idea who Abu Muslim was calling for. It was very well planned,
and very secretive movement. And all would, Abu Muslim would say, he is calling for the Khilafah to be out of the hands of Umayyah and back into the house of the Prophet. But no names were mentioned. No names were mentioned. And that is very important to understand. So what did Abu Muslim do in Khurasan? There were these many forces. Nasr bin Siyar was the pro-Umayyah governor. And you have Al-Garmani, who is leading the Yamani Arabs in that time. And he wants to fight Nasr ibn Siyar because they have tribal conflicts. And then you have Shaydan, who is from Al-Khawarij, who is also fighting both of them. And Abu Muslim al-Khurasani stood on the side until Al-Garmani attacked Nasr ibn Siyar in Marw. Marw was the capital of Khurasan. And at that time, when Al-Garmani was fighting Nasr ibn Marw, while the battle was still going on, Abu Muslim al-Khurasani moved to Marw. And he stopped the fighting. And Nasr ibn Siyar escaped from that area. However, after Abu Muslim al-Khurasani went into Marw, he gave settled the armies in Marw, and then he captured Al-Garmani and killed him. So he killed the Al-Garmani in Marw, and he was able to control the capital of Khurasan. After that, he moved his armies, and he fought Shaydan al-Haruri, and who was from the tribe of Rabi'ah, and he was able to finish him. So Abu Muslim al-Khurasani had full control over Khurasan. And still, Bani Umayyah, till that time, had no idea who Abu Muslim al-Khurasani was fighting for. Who were the main people behind the movement of Abu Muslim Khurasani? Abu Muslim Khurasani was looked upon like a rebel who wanted to have control over Khurasan. At the same time in Al-Kufa, the Abbasid, who at that time got to Muhammad ibn Ali ibn Abdullah, and his son after Ibrahim, they appointed a man called Abu Salam al-Khallab. Abu Salam worked as the leader of this underground movement to unseat the house of Umayyah and to lead the Shia. And he had a title, the first person in the Muslim world to be called Wazir, or Wazir. And his name was Waziru al-Muhammad, the Wazir of the house of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So again, there is no mention of the Abbasid, there is no mention of any Shia. This is all calling to bring the Khilafah back to the house of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he was recognized as the leader of this underground movement. And he was, he called for Abu Muslim Khurasani to move to take Al-Kufa, to take Al-Iraq. So now, the Abbasid have complete control and the person of Abu Muslim Khurasani over Khurasan, and now they asked him to move to Al-Kufa. At that time, Muhammad ibn Ali dies, and his son Ibrahim takes over the leadership. Ibrahim ibn Muhammad ibn Ali. During that time, there was correspondence between Ibrahim, who was the real leader. Now, Abu Salam al-Khallal was the front, okay? Now, the real leader of the Abbasid movement at that time was Ibrahim ibn Muhammad ibn Ali. I hope I'm not confusing you with all these names, but this chart would help. Ibrahim was the true leader of that Abbasid movement. And something happened after he took leadership is there were correspondence between the Abbasid, secret correspondence between the Abbasid and Abu Muslim Khurasan. Abu Muslim was the military power, and this was the religious and political leadership in Al-Kufa. So one of the letters that Ibrahim was sending to Abu Muslim Khurasani fell in the hands of Bani Umayyah. So for the first time at that time, Bani Umayyah knew who was the real mover and shaker behind the ideas of Abu Muslim Khurasani and the revolt of Abu Muslim Khurasani in Khurasan. And they called upon Ibrahim and Muhammad to come to Damascus. Now, he was not arrested. He was called by the Umayyah, but he knew that something is wrong. He knew what he's doing. He knew he's working to unseat the Umayyahs. And he's being called by the Khalifa. He had no choice but to go. But before he goes, he, like it's recorded in the history of Ahlid, he gave his own eulogy. He knew he's not coming back to his family,
And he appointed his brother Abdullah Abu al-Abbas. Now, his two brothers, the sons of Muhammad ibn Ali ibn Abdullah ibn Abbas, both of them are called Abdullah. But one of them will be known in history as Abdullah Abu al-Abbas al-Safah, and the other one will be known as Abdullah Abu Ja'far al-Mansur. Ibrahim never lives to become a Khalifa. His brothers do. So Ibrahim goes to Damascus, and he was killed by the people of by the Umayyad people, and Abdullah Abu al-Abbas becomes the leader after him for this Abbasid movement. But now it becomes apparent and obvious for Bani Umayyah who their enemies are, who is trying to unseat them. It was not the Shia Imamiyah, it was not the Shia Zaydiya, it was something they didn't really pay much attention to. It was a Shia Kaysaniya. It was the people that never revolted in public against them, and it was the house of al-Abbas and the person of Ibrahim ibn Muhammad ibn Ali who was killed, and then Abdullah ibn Abbas. But this plot was discovered very late by Umayyah, because Abu Musa al-Khurasani already had power and control over entire Khurasan, entire Persia, the entire eastern territory. Now we're in the hands of Abu Musa al-Khurasani and his armies, and he marched on to al-Kufa, where Abu al-Abbas was there, and he sent his leader al-Hasan ibn Qahtaba to move on, and he captured al-Kufa. And al-Kufa was captured in Rabi' al-Awwal, in the month of Rabi' al-Awwal, in the 132nd year after the hijrah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And Abdullah Abu al-Abbas, moved on to the masjid of al-Kufa, and he was claimed as the first Abbasid Khalifa. Now, he's not recognized by the scholars as a Khalifa at that time, because there was a Khalifa in Damascus. Marwan ibn Muhammad was the Khalifa in Damascus, and Abu al-Abbas ibn Muhammad ibn Ali was the Khalifa in al-Kufa. And he got up on the minbar, and he gave a very good speech to the people of al-Kufa, and he said, just excerpt from that speech, he said, Ya Ahl al-Kufa, antum mahallu mahabbatina wa manzul muwaddatina. You are our supporters, you are the supporters of the Shia, basically, the supporters of Ahlul Bayt. He's speaking in the name of the house of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he said, you have never changed, you endured, you persevered through the time of Umayyah. لم تتغيروا على ذلك ولم يثنيكم عنه تحامل أهل الجور عليكم, meaning the people of Umayyah, the transgressors, حتى أدركتم زمننا, until you come to our time, meaning the house of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. وأتاكم الله بدولتنا, and our government now is brought to you by Allah سبحانه وتعالى. And he said, فاستعدوا, be prepared. فأنا السفاح المبيح, I am the bloodletter, a safah. Safah is the slaughterer, the bloodletter. Meaning I will do anything I can to really bring down the house of Umayyah, even if it takes all the bloodshed that is needed for that. And that word that he used, a safah, became his title. His name became Abu al-Abbas Safah. And that was taken from that particular speech. And then his uncle Dawood ibn Ali came up to the member and he gave another speech, and he said, we will work like the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam worked, and we will work with the tradition of Abdullah ibn Abbas and Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. After that, they had, the last mission was to basically eliminate the Khalifa in Damascus, Marwan ibn Muhammad. But what happened is Marwan Muhammad took and made a huge army to bring the revolt down. And it was 120,000 fighters. The exact number of the Abbasid army was not well known in history, but they were less than that. And the Abbasid army moved up by the leadership of Abdullah ibn Ali. Abdullah ibn Ali is the uncle of Abu al-Abbas al-Safah, his father's brother. And they moved up, the two armies met in the battle of Al-Zab, Al-Zab al-Kabir. Al-Zab is the river of Al-Zab, which is one of the tributaries of Dajla, of the river in Iraq. And the two armies met, and the army of Umayyah was defeated decisively in that battle. And the Abbasid army started to chase Marwan ibn Muhammad into Damascus, and he fled Damascus into Egypt.
And he was captured in a small village in Egypt called Busir. Busir is the village of the scholar that Busiri came from later on. But he was captured in Busir, and he was killed in Busir, and that was in Dhul-Hijjah. And the, in 27th of Dhul-Hijjah, in 132 after the Hijrah, and that was August 5th, in 750 years of the common era. And that was the first day as the scholar recognized the dynasty of Al-Abbasidin. And the first Khalifa was Abu al-Abbas al-Saffah. And he was a Khalifa, like, you know, he was born in the 104th year after the Hijrah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He lived to the 136th. He was a Khalifa in the 132nd Hijrah, 132nd year after the Hijrah. So he was a Khalifa for 4 years. And he died at the age of 32. So he was really a young Khalifa, and he died young at that time. His entire Khilafah legacy was really just very very appropriate to his name, As-Saffah, the blood shedder, the blood letter. And what he did is he basically killed many in the people of the House of Umayyah. Many of them fled to Spain, and in Spain they formed their own Khilafah by Abd al-Rahman ibn Muawiyah, who's known as Abd al-Rahman al-Dakhil or Sahar Quraysh, and that will be, inshallah, subject for another session. But then after he died, his brother Abu Ja'far, Abdullah Abu Ja'far al-Mansur, became Khalifa in 136 years after the Hijrah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And I will leave, inshallah, some information about Abu Ja'far al-Mansur for the next session, and then that will be, inshallah, the prelude to our study of the life of the great four imams. And we will start with Abu Hanifa al-Nu'man radiallahu anhu, and then move on to Imam Malik, and then move on to Imam Shafi'i, and then we'll finish the series of the great Imams by studying the life of Ahmad ibn Hanbal. But I wanted you to understand the political atmospheres. The Muslim scholars in particular were very unhappy with the House of Umayyah. And they were looking forward to the House of Abbas to bring about the correction, the rectification, to bring about the tradition of the Sahaba, the companions, but that was not happening. And we will see how the scholars themselves turned against Umayyah first, but they turned against the House of Abbas after that. And some of them did, and we will study that, inshallah, in our study of the life of the great Imams. But we will conclude, inshallah, with the dua, and I will leave the floor to Brother Nabi to introduce some guests that we will have, inshallah, tonight. سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون وسلام على المرسلين والحمد لله رب العالمين